Hello friends, welcome to Chiva IAS. How are you? I hope you are doing well. So friends, as you know that on our channel, we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services, and for that purpose, we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So currently friends, we have 12 series that target your prelims and one series that target your mains. So friends, what we do in these prelims oriented series, what we have done, basically we have divided your whole syllabus of UPSC into 12 subtopics like Ancient India, Medieval India, Modern India, Art and Culture, Polity, Geography, Economy, Current Affairs, Government Schemes, International Relations and so on. So we have divided your syllabus into 12 subtopics and we daily cover 2 subtopics. In this manner, in 6 days, your all 12 subtopics are covered. So we will continue to do so till 31st May. So why the date chosen has been 31st May? Because on 2nd June is your prelims of UPSC CSE 2019 and we will end this series only one day before your prelims exam. So friends, let's start the discussion. So today this lecture is about the Indian polity and the lecture number is 6. So let's see what are the questions of today's lecture. So the first question is, the D.K. Basu guidelines given by the Supreme Court are related to A. Attachment of assets of bankrupt companies, B. Rehabilitation of children who are victims of trafficking and sexual abuse, C. Procedure of arrest, detention and interrogation of any person, and the D option is regulation of foreign NGOs working in India. So let me tell you friends that here we have been asked that D.K. Basu guidelines that were given by Supreme Court, they were related to. So the answer is C, that is procedure of arrest, detention and interrogation of any person. So these guidelines were given by Supreme Court while doing the procedure of arrest of any person or detention for that matter interrogation. So C is the correct answer. So here are some guidelines that police officials, they must carry out the arrest or interrogation. They should clearly wear their clothes, their dress, and they should have accurate and visible identification and the name tags with their designations. And also there must be a memo of arrest that should be prepared at the time of arrest and should also include the time and date of the arrest. And it must be attested by at least one witness who could include a family member of the person arrested. Also this arrest memo should be countersigned by a person arrested so that discretionary time and date is not added to it. So third is that basically the person arrested or detained or being interrogated has a right to inform to a relative, friend or well-wisher. And also one thing is more that if the relative lives outside the district, then the time place of arrest and venue of custody must be notified by police within 8 to 12 hours after arrest. So this is about your first question. Let's move on to the second question. Second question is, which of the following are the key features of Indian secularism? First, the constitution does not give a special status to any religion. Second, the constitution allows the state to intervene in the religious matters in order to ensure equality within religious communities. Third, the state can regulate even control religious institutions. So we have to choose that which of the above statements is correct. Let me tell you friends that yes, first is correct. There is no special religion in India. For example, in Pakistan, the special status is given to Islam. In Sri Lanka, the special status is given to Buddhism, or for that matter in Britain, the special status is given to Christianity, but no such special status is given to any religion in India. So first is correct. Regarding second statement friends, second statement is also correct. The constitution allows the state to intervene in any matter, in the religious matters, in order to ensure equality. So for example, the constitution of India bans untouchability, which was the practice earlier prevalent in Hinduism, Hindu Varna system. And also recently, 1 year back, the Supreme Court declared this triple talaq as or nikah halala as unconstitutional. So it was the purpose of this was to ensure equality within religious communities. So third statement is also correct friends. The state can regulate even control religious institutions, and the example of this is the Shrine Board of Jammu and Kashmir, the Jammu temple, that is of the temple of Vaishno Devi. So there the Shrine Board is under government control, and the purpose of such control and regulation is to ensure that this revenue of the temple or for that matter religious institution is shared equitably without establishing any monopoly of a particular private group or of a particular individual on the religious institution. So all the statements are correct, that is D. Answer is that D. So 1, 2 and 3 all are correct. So there is no religion, official religion for India, and all the individuals can profess, practice and propagate any religion, and also the constitution prohibits discrimination of grounds of or discrimination on grounds of religion. And regarding this, state can control, for example, the Vaishno Devi shrine board is in state control. So as I have told you that it is to curb actually the private monopoly. Let's move on to the third statement. Third statement is, if there was no right to constitutional remedies in the constitution, which of the following would follow? A, a citizen would not be able to move court at all. B, there would be no rule of law in the country. C, separation of powers between legislature and executive would be completely diluted. D, a democratic government may turn authoritarian. So friends, this is a little bit tricky question, so you have to answer it carefully. Let me tell you friends that most of students will say that A is the answer. Friends, A is not the answer. A is incorrect, because citizen, here we have been saying that if the right to constitutional remedies in the constitution is not available, then which of the following would follow? Here, if you say that citizen would not be able to move court at all, then it is incorrect, because the citizen cannot move in case of fundamental rights or for that for constitutional rights, but he can move for the enforcement of his legal rights. So in case of any legal dispute, for example, he can move the court. So the lack of constitutional remedies applies only to the fundamental rights, so that in case it is not in existence, then the citizen would not be able to approach the court for the breach of fundamental rights. Regarding second answer, friend, second is, or B is not also the answer, because there is no necessary condition there that for the rule of law there must be constitutional remedies. Without constitutional remedies there can be rule of law, which is in fact established by Article 14. But yes, right to constitutional remedies helps in maintaining the rule of law. So certainly it is not necessary condition, but it leads to rule of law. So it helps in maintaining this rule of law, which can also be maintained by the kind of, we can say, vice of the state government of the day. So C is, friend, certainly not correct. So D is the answer, because the lack of constitutional remedies makes democratic government authoritarian, because if there are no limits on the state's power, that is no limits which it cannot cross, then it will certainly lead to kind of authoritarianism. So answer is D. So here is the explanation. Already I have explained you in detail, so there is no need of wasting time here. Let's move on to the next question, fourth question. Fourth question is, consider the following statements. A, a ministry is which loses confidence of the Rajya Sabha is obliged to resign. Reason, the Council of Ministers is collectively responsible to the Rajya Sabha. So we have to choose the correct answer. Let me tell you friends that A is wrong, because the ministry, the Council of Ministers, they if they lose confidence in the Rajya Sabha, then they are obliged to resign. It is not necessary to ensure the majority of the government in the Rajya Sabha, but it is necessary to ensure the majority of the government of the day in Lok Sabha. So Council of Ministers is collectively responsible to Lok Sabha and not Rajya Sabha. So both A and R are incorrect. So here answer would be D. Both A and R are incorrect. So solution is D. So you can see that a ministry which loses confidence of the Lok Sabha must resign it, and not in case of Rajya Sabha. So this is about your fourth question. Let's move on to the fifth question. Fifth question is, which of the following statements with reference to office of Vice President of India is correct? A, state legislatures are not part of the electoral college of the Vice President. B, the Vice President may be removed from his office by a resolution of the Rajya Sabha passed by majority and agreed to by the Lok Sabha. C, the Vice President acts as the ex officio chairman of the Rajya Sabha and takes over the office of the President when there is a vacancy. Let me tell you friends that certainly C is correct, because Vice President is the ex officio chairman of Rajya Sabha, and also B is correct, because Vice President can be removed from his office by the resolution of Rajya Sabha, which can be passed by majority, and that resolution must be agreed to by the Lok Sabha, and then Vice President will be stand removed. So A is also correct, because state legislatures are not part of electoral college of Vice President. In fact, they are part of the electoral college of President and not the Vice President. So the A, B, C all are correct. So the answer would be D, that all of the above are correct. So here is the explanation. As I've already told you, the Vice President is elected for 5 years. So the members of state legislatures do not form part of its electoral college. And Vice President acts as President only until a new President is elected, and is also the chairman of Rajya Sabha. So let's move on to the sixth question. Sixth question is, the bureaucracy in India is expected to be politically neutral. Political neutrality implies that the bureaucracy will not, one, take a purely political decision on policy matters, second, contest for political offices, third, implement policies and schemes that have a political objective. So friends, let me tell you that this here the correct statement, we have to choose the correct statement. Yes, friends, the a bureaucrat cannot take political position on policy matters. He have to, basically the purpose of the bureaucracy is to implement the policies and laws of the government of the day. So it cannot be the bureaucrats cannot be cannot take political position. So first is correct, yes. The second is also correct because they cannot contest for political offices. Regarding third statement, friends, third is not correct because ultimately every policy has some kind of political motive behind it. So if, for example, you can say that the government is doing farm loan waiver, so certainly there is a political motive, but the bureaucrat of the day has to implement those policies. So third is not correct. So here the answer would be only 1 and 2. So A would be the answer here, 1 and 2 only. So here is the explanation. So the bureaucrat must act impartially and implement the government policies in an apolitical manner. So let's move on to the seventh question. Seventh question is, the prime minister and all the ministers have to be members of the parliament. If someone becomes a minister or prime minister without being an MP, which of these follows? A, he must obtain a special approval from the parliament to continue in the office. B, he should get trial presidential consent if he continues in the office for a period of more than 6 months. See, such a person has to get elected to the parliament within 6 months, for failing which he stands removed from the office. D, none of the above. So we have to choose that which of the following is correct. Let me tell you, friends, that the prime minister and all the ministers, they must be member of parliament. And in case a person becomes prime minister, or for that matter the minister, he must become a member of the parliament within 6 months of his being chosen as prime minister or minister. So the answer is C. So this case is the example of this case is our former Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, who was who became the Prime Minister of India, but he was not the member of the Parliament, and then subsequently he was elected in Rajya Sabha from Assam, from a constituency in Assam. So the solution is C, that is, such a person has to get elected to the Parliament within 6 months, failing which he stands removed from the office. So here is the explanation, so you can see it. Let's move on to the next question. Consider the following about 00R in Parliament. First, MPs are free to raise any matter which they believe to be important in the 00R. Second, ministers are bound to reply on the House floor on the matters raised in 00R. So friends, we have to consider the statements about 00R. Let me tell you, friends, that first statement is correct, that MPs are free to raise any matter which they believe to be important in 00R. But let me tell you, friends, that second is not correct because ministers are not bound to reply on the House floor in this on the matters raised in 00R. So the answer is one only. So A would be the answer. So here is the justification. Basically, there are different type of mechanisms through which Parliament can exercise its control over the executive. For example, question hour, 00R, half an hour discussion, adjournment, motion. So basically, in question hour, the questions are raised in every day during sessions of the Parliament, and the ministers are bound to give answers to these. They have to respond to these searching questions raised by the members. Regarding 00R, friends, members are free to raise any matter, but it is not important for the minister to reply it. So this is about your this question, eighth question. Let's move on to the ninth question. Ninth question is, nothing in this article shall prevent the state from making any provision for the reservation of appointments or posts in favor of any backward class of citizens which in the opinion of the state is not adequately represented in the services under the state. This is a provision found in. So here we have to choose in which of the following this provision is found. A, DPSP, B, fundamental rights, C, special constitutional rights under part 6, and D is National Commission for Backward Classes Act. So we have to choose that which of the following is correct. Let me tell you, friend, that here this provision of not of kind of allowing the state to discriminate in case of reservation in favor of any backward classes of citizens, this provision is a part of fundamental rights. So it is the article 16 clause 4 specifically. If you want to know, the article 16 sub clause 4 is the provision that is mentioned in the question. So the solution is B. So here is the explanation. Let's move on to the 10th question, that is the last question of this lecture. Consider the following statements. First, the institutions run by the state will not give any religious education to ensure the neutrality of state in matters of religion. Second, the government will not discriminate between educational institutions when granting aid on the basis of their management being under particular minority community. So we have to choose that which of the above is correct. So here let me tell you friends that both of these are correct. The institutions that are run by the state, educational institute, they cannot provide any religious instruction because it is basically to ensure the state neutrality in terms of religion, as we are a secular state. Regarding the second statement also friends, second statement is correct because while the government is providing any aid to educational institutes, it cannot discriminate against any particular educational institute by saying that it is being run by a particular minority community. So both 1 and 2 are correct. So the solution is C, that is both 1 and 2. So here is the explanation, you can see it. So this is all about friends today's lecture. If you like the video, if you like the question, then please ensure that you do hit a like, and also ensure that you share it with your friends, and also friends, also ensure that you subscribe to our channel. Also do not forget to press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the important notifications relating to UPSC CSE 2019. So friends, in case you want to subscribe to the PDFs of these MCQs, you can contact us at this email ID, that is achieveies21@gmail.com, or for that matter you can contact us at this mobile number, that is 8968426481. So this is a contact number on which WhatsApp is also available, so you can also WhatsApp us. So in case you want to subscribe to these PDFs, you can contact us at this email ID, or for that matter this number. So friends, obviously there will be a certain cost for the PDF subscription, because as we are putting in a lot of effort, so certainly we need some more type of motivation to sustain ourselves so that we can continue to help you people also. So in case you want to join, then you can contact us. The fees is kept as minimum as possible so that you people can also afford it. So friends, this is all about today's lecture. If you like the video, if you like the questions, then please do it a like. Thank you friends, have a very nice day. Thank you very much.